Welcome to the Startup Success Podcast for people interested in making useful and valuable software companies. Brought to you by MoreAware, makers of software for countertop fabricators. Visit moreaware.com/company to see if you're a fit for our team. Today we have a very special guests, return guests, Daniel Kivatinos and Michael Nusimow, founder of DrChrono. How are you two today?
We're doing well.
So, hard to believe, but it has been 7 years since we spoke to you. Can you give us the high points of the last 7 years? What are some of the milestones you've hit in that time?
Sure. So, it's been a long journey. You know, I think we talked to you right when we were starting DrChrono.
I think so, yeah.
Before we took any venture backing. And, you know, in that time, we've raised a little bit over $8 million in venture capital. We did the very prestigious Y Combinator incubator program back in 2011.
Nice.
We were the first healthcare company to ever pass through there. And I think there's, you know, we've definitely evolved our business in many ways. Today at DrChrono, the way we understand our business is there's three major components. The first is really focusing on mobile and healthcare and giving great mobile tools to doctors. So we have an award-winning iPad and iPhone-based mobile electronic health record solution for doctors. Mm-hmm. And essentially what this tool does is everything a doctor needs to do when they're in an exam room with a patient, they can do it on their iPad and now on their iPhone. So they can see a patient's complete medical history, create new clinical documentation, send a prescription to any pharmacy in the United States, send a lab order and receive lab results for blood work and biopsy to any lab in the United States, send an electronic medical claim to any insurance company in the U.S. And they do all of this on their iPad and iPhone. They don't need a stack of paper in the room. They don't need a prescription pad. They don't need a laptop or a computer in the room. It's really mobile. And it's great because it allows them to really interact with their patients better. Doctors really react to that. And that's, you know, one of our most distinctive features that really sets us apart from every other vendor in the healthcare space, is that relentless focus on mobile. Mm-hmm. And one of the reasons we're the best is we launched on the iPad back in April 2010. And that's right when the iPad was released. So if you want to be the best at something, it helps if you're the first. They work for Harvard. They're widely seen as the best university in the country. And one reason is they happen to also be the first one. So if you show up on the first day, great way to be successful, to become the CEO of a company, just show up the first day and you've got a good shot at it. So that's just one part of our business. And we essentially give that away for free.
Okay.
We give that away for the doctors. You could download it on the iPad or iPhone. And the doctor could sign up in under 30 seconds and have all that software free and available to them. And where we monetize is with our second area of business, which is a really old and traditional, you know, healthcare IT business called practice management software, mm-hmm. which usually includes things like scheduling all of your patients, running a doctor's office, and doing medical billing and accounting. And we offer this on DrChrono.com. It's a SaaS platform that the doctors and their staff would use to basically run their whole practice, run the business side of things, and get paid from insurance companies and patients and track all of those dollars flowing into their business. And that's a part that we charge for and where we make most of our revenue. And a third part of our tech stack are our tools for patients and it's a brand we call On Patient, where mm-hmm. patients will use their iPhone and iPad and any internet browser to interact with their doctor, to communicate, send secure messages, pay their bills, see their complete medical history, help organize their medical history for their family, their children and relatives and other people they're caring for. And the last part of our business is something called revenue cycle management, which it's growing in importance for us in the last 2 years. And revenue cycle management is essentially where we help to take over the pain of managing a medical practice and actually provide support. And essentially, we take over the work that a doctor does for all interacting with insurance companies and accounts receivable for their patients. And we actually provide staffing that will do that.
Wow.
And we become kind of business partners with the doctor, and we essentially take a percentage of their revenue, but also, you know, kind of free them up from the task of either having to hire staff and do all this billing and accounting work for themselves and, you know, following up on insurance companies. About a third of all claims that doctors initially submit to insurance companies get rejected for one reason or another. Right. And you have to relentlessly follow up every day to respond to those claims to get doctors paid. So doctors either, the market's pretty evenly split. Doctors either do this themselves with some staff members in-house, or they outsource it to just a service provider. So we're doing both. We are giving them the software solution and helping them provide the services and I think we have a huge advantage there. And it's a really interesting business that we find ourselves in, and it's one of our fastest growing pieces of our business. And it's been growing really fast for the last 2 years. And I think one of the reasons it's so interesting is that part of the business is not a tech business traditionally. That's a business that's a heavy staff business. Like, there are giant outsource companies that just, they kind of like throw human beings at this problem, just assign, you know, thousands and thousands of human beings to do all of this grunt work and paperwork. And right. We're trying to make it a technology problem and, you know, come up with automations and software that will, if not completely replace the human beings that are doing this, give, you know, have it so that much fewer people can do this and have a much wider, a much greater force multiplier, much bigger lever with technology, so that one person could do the work that 10 used to be doing, and just replacing phone calls, replacing paperwork. So, you know, we've really evolved from, I think we've spoken with you twice, actually. Once when we started the company, I think we spoke again after we did Y Combinator briefly.
Okay, that's
so right. Yeah, so I think, you know, we've definitely come a long way. I think even at the last stopping point of 2011, which was still almost 5 years ago, the last time we chatted, we really went from this really cool app that was like, you know, a mobile iPad EHR that was really hot because it was kind of the new thing, where we've really evolved and grown out of that app business to be a real fully featured platform, all the way from, you know, this great app, which really was a killer feature, like we'll win over customers and it really sets us apart, to have this killer app on the iPad that makes the doctor look good. It makes them really more productive and better able to interact with their patients. But we really expand it to be a complete platform for doctors, where they have this great point of care tool, but then we take over their business, give them software to help them make more money and run, you know, do a lot of heavy lifting in their business, and all the way going even further, really leaning in with our customers and becoming a business partner with them, saying, hey, we are only going to get paid when you get paid by all these insurance companies that could be cagey and difficult to deal with. So we've really grown up a lot as a business, going from kind of a small tech-focused app, you know, app company, to a really much broader service provider company that really, for doctors, we can really run their whole practice. It's kind of a medical practice tech solution and service solution in a box, where the doctors can really focus on their patients and practicing medicine. And we really take care of a lot of the business and tech teams for them. And it's a much better business. The more pain you solve for your customers, the more revenue that's in it. Doctors are willing to pay more because we're doing so much more for them. And I think what I've really found over the last few years is that there's definitely a really strong alignment with there. We've done a lot of experiments to see where the most value is for our customers. And this is one where the technology and service model really merges, where, you know, the doctor's clinical notes on the iPad directly flow into the back end. So there's a really good reason that we're doing both. It's not that we just did two random things. They really have this kind of organic flow that has a right. real, you know, a real dependence on each other, and actually like 2 + 2 = 10, where because we're doing both of those things for a doctor, that's not normally happening in the rest of the industry. So because we're doing their front end technology solution and their back office, we're able to give them a much bigger productivity boost because we have that full picture of what's going on with them. So it's kind of natural that we're doing these services on top of our tech.
When you started out 7 years ago, or even when we last talked 5 years ago, were the service part of things on your roadmap, or did you just kind of evolve there?
Yeah, I think they were not on our roadmap at all.
Wow.
It was one experiment out of maybe 10 different ones we did, where we tried to have different products and different service offerings to doctors. And I think we started doing it around 2012. We launched a pilot program and onboarded a few customers. And we really learned a lot. I think in the last 2 years, that business has really grown a lot. And we'll see that an average customer on our services business produces 10 times the revenue of a customer just on our software business.
Wow.
And that's what we look at today and realize, like, that's a big part of the future where we're doing more work for it. It has a slightly worse margin, but there's just 10 times more revenue, so a lot more profit. And as we look at it in the long term, and kind of the vision we would maybe pitch to, you know, employees and even to investors, is that, you know, in the long term, our technology kind of values and our skills as a technologist and as a technology company, we're going to turn this services business into a software business and get right. the kind of margins you see from a software business, which is really attractive. So yeah,
quick question here. I mean, when I hear experiment, I think lean startup methodology. Is that those 10 experiments that you ran, and this one being, you know, the services being the most successful, was that something you learned at Y Combinator or something you just decided to go for? I mean, what's the context for that?
Yeah, I think it's a tactic we learned at Y Combinator. And I think there's a really great thing about being a venture-backed company where, and I think it comes directly from Paul Graham at Y Combinator, who often writes, you know, initially the greatest startups in the world look like a single feature. And even said, you know, Microsoft initially looked like, you know, a basic compiler company, but they grew into a lot more from that. And I think it followed that model. And also what I've learned over the last few years is even post Y Combinator, when you're talking with investors, you know, you have a certain business. And I think, you know, we've been working at this for a long time for almost 8 years on DrChrono. So we've achieved a lot. We have a lot of product. We have a lot of revenue. We have all these great employees and all these happy customers. So you really want to, like, you know, when you're talking to investors, pitch them on, hey, look at all this great stuff we've accomplished. And they kind of don't care about that. They want to hear about that in like 30 seconds just to see that you're a serious person they should talk to. And what they really care is your vision for the future and your aspirations. And one of the most powerful ways you can present your company to investors, and some of the best companies I've seen when I've gotten to see their investor pitches and seen some of the info they put out, is that they present themselves as a two-stage rocket that, hey, this is the thing we've done so far. It's like stage one of the rocket. We have to do a ton of work to break free, you know, from the Earth's gravity. But, you know, now we're going to strip off these booster rockets and we're going to shift into a different gear. And this is stage two of the company. And I've seen it in companies like Stripe, where, you know, you could see they started off as a credit card processing company and they just launched their Atlas offering, which I think is stage two of the company, where, you know, they want to be this platform for small businesses. And it's kind of weird when you see really small startups who have an app or a single feature and they think they're going to take over the world with it. It seems kind of crazy and you almost want to laugh at it, because it's like, you know, we're building an app that lets two people like each other's faces and we're going to change the way people interact with each other. But I think it's useful to think about, especially when you talk to investors, because you kind of have to realize that, you know, if you're able to really dominate on one set of app features and capture a lot of attention, you have an audience and a platform to do something great. And I think some of the best companies, they're always thinking about that. And I think it does change, because, you know, you might think you're doing something now that's making revenue and building product and you should keep doing it. But there's kind of an end game you're working towards where, you know, as the business changes, there could be different outcomes that become really powerful. And it's a useful thought exercise. It's kind of, you know, the strategy and planning is often invaluable, even if you throw them away when you go out to execute. That thinking about your business, knowing your industry, knowing where there could be money, you really have to be open to changing the game plan based on so many variables that are in and out of your control, based on execution and how the market looks. So I definitely think, you know, in every investor pitch, you're always kind of pitching this two-stage rocket. Hey, this is what we're doing today, and we're about to, you know, pour all this, you know, gasoline on this burning hockey stick of growth and take the company in this direction. And I think it's really valuable. It's a really valuable way for anyone to think about their business, that, you know, we've accomplished so much today, but there's so much more we can accomplish in the future. And from a very practical sense, that's kind of the aspirational part. From a very practical sense, it really increases your valuation and your total addressable market. And, you know, that's something that's very hard tack and hard numbers that investors and business people look at. And I think a lot of product people and entrepreneurs who come from a product background may overlook. But the two things are really, you know, I think there's a zen in being able to see both, that as your product grows, your total addressable market, if you could find a way, you know, we're selling software to, you know, doctors, and we found a way to offer them a service offering that could get us, you know, 10 times more revenue from every doctor.
Sure.
And, you know, numbers wise, that makes great sense. What and it looks really good, but it fits in on the product side as well.
So what about competition? Do you care about your competition, or do you only focus on your customers? And in terms of competition, I think of kind of an old guard of stodgy healthcare software providers. Again, do you pay attention to them? Do they pay attention to you? How has that evolved?
Yeah, that's a really great question. I think healthcare and providing software for doctors, it's an incredibly competitive field. Mm-hmm. I think I learned a really valuable lesson. I used to work at a software company called Bloomberg LP, which provides software and essentially a SaaS platform to financial people all over the world. And it's a really successful company. And one of their values they had there from their founder, Michael Bloomberg, was that this is something at least they told me when I was there, is that, you know, you never look at the competition because they're just kind of, you know, they did their best to go out and listen to the customers and build a product.
Right.
And if you just copied your competition, they may not have listened to the customer very well. So you should really go out there and talk to the customer yourself directly. Mm-hmm. And you'll find, you know, that your competition didn't get the story 100% correct. That's why there's room for competition. So I would say, unfortunately, the bar in healthcare software was incredibly low. Being in the healthcare industry for the last 8 years or so, I understand why. There are these giant enterprise hospital vendors like Epic and Cerner that are kind of the oracles of the world. Mm-hmm. And they're going out and selling $50 million giant enterprise solutions to hospitals. And they always kind of ignore the private practice market, which is a completely different market. And in the last 8 years, there's been some regulatory changes where the adoption of electronic health record tools like DrChrono, mm-hmm. when we started the company in 2008, 2009, adoption was somewhere around 3 or 4%. And according to a poll last year, adoption is broken over 80% of doctors in the US are using some kind of EHR tool. So we've gone through a period of really rapid adoption due to healthcare regulations. The government was paying stimulus money to doctors for adopting systems and putting penalties if they didn't. So there was a huge amount of heat and energy in this field. So there was an explosion of startups that were doing the types of things DrChrono did, many of which have already died off. So there's, you know, so in our market, and I think there's other markets similar, there are these giant enterprise vendors that were, you know, have been around for decades and their products aren't very good, but that's normal for enterprise software. They're able to, you know, their actual product magic is in being able to sell to and service a giant, you know, multi-thousand person organization. Their product itself, the end users often hate it, but the magic is in somehow they close that sale and are keeping it alive.
So is that just a different customer? I mean, you said you're going after more of the, is it fair to say smaller practices or just a different part of the practice?
Yeah, exactly right. So we're targeting ambulatory practices, which are all of the healthcare practices outside of hospitals.
Oh, okay. Cool.
So anyone who's not in a hospital, we're targeting them. And it's a really long tail market.
Okay.
About 80% of the medical practices outside of hospitals are smaller 1 to 10 doctor providers. So those are really selling to SMBs. And if you're great at selling to a 10,000 person hospital, you could be terrible at selling to a 10 doctor medical practice with 20 staff members because their needs are so different. And I do think the model I always like to look at is Oracle CRM versus Salesforce. When I was at Y Combinator, Mark Benioff, the CEO and founder of Salesforce, talked mm-hmm. there and he gave a dinner session. And one of the things he told us was that, you know, Oracle used to have a thing when, you know, hey, if you encounter a sales organization with fewer than 30 people,
yep.
run. Don't walk away from them, run away. And Salesforce, when they were selling, you know, they were really one of the first SaaS providers. They started selling in the 90s and they really, those are the only people they could sell to. They couldn't compete with Oracle
right.
and sell to a 10,000 person company. If you were a 5-person sales shop, they were the only game in town and they were so happy to have you because
right.
they could sell to you and learn from you. And you would, you know, you would be happy with a product that changed every day. And you could actually give them feedback and they'd listen to it and you'd see the software change to help meet your needs better. And I think that's very much the way the market looks to me now. We're selling to smaller 1 to 20 doctor organizations. And we've seen some of them grow to become, you know, some of our largest customers have hundreds of users in, you know, 8 different states. And they started at small orgs with us and grew. So we're seeing great change there. And I think our long-term aspirations is to move up market. You know, I think
okay.
there's multiple billion-dollar companies to build just selling to ambulatory practices. And that's
right.
our goal for the next 5 years. But, you know, in the long run, I see just how Salesforce, you know, they started with those small 1-5 salesperson shops, and now they're selling to, you know, the majority of the Fortune 500 and have kind of crushed Oracle in the CRM business,
yeah,
even at the higher end.
Yeah.
Oracle, you know, I was just reading today, Oracle finally bought a cloud computing company, but they were kind of the big iron, you know, server on-premises vendor. And they're still a really successful company. It's just that
Right. They've
kind of had their future growth eaten into by this new multi-billion dollar company, Salesforce. And I see that happening in the healthcare space, whether it's DrChrono and other vendors like us that are more, you know, SaaS-centered, mobile-focused vendors. And I think we've seen it in multiple markets. And just taking a step back, I think, you know, with competition, it's always good to be aware, but kind of my values that I learned at Bloomberg and I still hold today are that, you know, your competition will never get it 100% right. Unfortunately, you will never get it 100% right. So, you know, always focusing on the customer is one of the most valuable things. And they'll tell you what your competitors are doing well and what they're doing poorly. And they'll do that through the sales cycle. They'll do it when they're using your product and ask for enhancements.
Right.
They hate this other vendor, they do it better, or you're kicking these guys' butts in mobile. And they'll even tell you when they leave your platform, unfortunately.
Right.
When a customer turns and goes to another customer, they're kind of voting with their feet. And if you see that you're losing all of your, you know, even if you don't have high churn issues and have a lot of customers leaving, if you see, really look at who your customers go to when they leave you, it tells you a lot about them, about the competitor, about yourself. And it's one of those ugly parts of the business that a lot of product people don't like looking at, but it's always valuable to look at that input and see if you have one vendor who's really up and coming. It is good to identify them and say, hey, why are we losing customers to this vendor?
How
could we do better?
Can I jump in on that and say another place is, I get the impression that some of your customers could also be lost by becoming part of a bigger practice. Now, does your services work help? It seems to me when you told me about making it easier for them to focus on their practice, that also gives them the alternative to avoid having to join one of these large hospital-associated firms, which is seems to me the other big alternative for them. Is that true? And if so, then you're also kind of putting a moat against that trend. Am I getting that right, or is that just not quite how the industry works?
Yeah, I think it's spot on. We haven't seen a huge amount of providers leaving private practice to go to larger groups. It's definitely a trend in the market.
Right.
But I think it's a pendulum that swings both ways, where there's tons of doctors who leave hospitals and larger groups and, you know, want that personal experience. They want to be an entrepreneur themselves and have more say over the kind of healthcare they give their patients. But I think you're 100% right. If we, you know, a large part of churn for any SaaS business will unfortunately be when your customer goes out of business, and whether that's, you know, they have to shut their business down or their business gets acquired by a larger company. It's kind of, you know, natural churn that happens. And any small business, you know, if there's a 2-doctor practice and one of those doctors leaves the practice, all of a sudden their revenue was slashed in half and their expenses are doubled. It's really hard to operate a business when that happens. So if you can help your customers be more successful and be more profitable, I mean, I think, you know, as an entrepreneur, I really identify with all the doctors running their own practices that they want to be independent. And I think even as, you know, another solution to that problem is to sell the larger practices. Like if you have these doctors who loved using you at smaller practices, their practices may grow to become a 100-doctor practice and they'll bring your product along for that wonderful journey. Or even if they become a member of a new org, if they really loved your product, they'll become an advocate. You know, you'll have an agent inside this larger org that's going to try and, you know, one of the first things hopefully they'll do, and we've had users this passionate, is, you know, how do I get this new practice? You know, I hate the other software they're on. How do I get them using DrChrono? And that's something you strive to do with your product and experience to make your customers huge advocates of you. And you'd almost want that trend to accelerate so we could sell into larger groups.
That's awesome.
Speaking of customers, you mentioned before that you actually now have a patient-facing side to your business. In other words, you're actually providing the patients of your main customers with information that they could not get before. You know, I really appreciate that because I am in a large HMO and they're using Windows 98. need I say more? So I'm curious, how much of that is a competitive advantage for your primary customers there?
So this is Daniel talking. It is a huge advantage. So we sort of see the doctor as the primary customer, but who pays the doctor? It's the patient. Mm-hmm. If the patient mm-hmm. continually comes back to the physician and they have a good experience, then we're doing our job. Now, when anybody goes to the doctor, they really want to get access to everything that the doctor had given them, whether it be the patient education material or the bill or what prescription drugs they're on or what labs have been taken. You want all that data. It's your data. So part of, I would say, our company culture is to allow the patient to get access to that data. One milestone that happened in the company is we were actually invited to the White House several months ago.
Nice.
To meet President Obama and to basically talk about this particular issue in giving the patients their data and what does that mean. So I flew to the White House. We met with President Obama and the team there, and really we sat down and worked on these problems, saying what is it going to take for patients to get their data? What is it going to take to create something called more precise medicine? So if you're able to get your data and all your doctors can see that data, how does that create precision medicine? So say you have like a patient who has cancer, you want to know everything that's possible to create a better outcome. What's happening right now in healthcare is a physician sort of is doing what's given to them. So it's like statistically, a physician will say, well, this drug will keep you alive at an 80% ratio. I'll give you this drug. They're not going to tell the patient that, but they're going to try that drug because it's the highest ratio. But if you get even more precise, so say you take a genetics test and you have your genomic sequence in your app, right? So you have that in DrChrono on the patient end, and a physician is able to look at that and say, oh my God, these five drugs are actually, they work better because of your genomic sequence. How do they know that? Because other patients with a similar genetic sequence will actually have responded well to that drug. So a lot of it, what we're trying to do is allow this data to flow directly to the patient, but also engage other doctors in the right way. And we're working on the Precision Medicine Initiative, which is a government initiative where we're working to essentially give that data to the patient to enable them to do what they want with it. They, you know, healthcare should be more precise.
So
instead of you going to the doctor, yep.
So precision medicine isn't going to become like the paperless office, i.e. something that was predicted for 20 years and, you know, pretty much never happened. You see it in a much closer time frame.
Yeah, and the one thing I would add is one really critical component for the Precision Medicine Initiative is also sharing data with researchers to help them make those scientific connections between genetics data and response to treatment that doctors, they just don't have access to it today. It's just not practical, you know, for 99% of the U.S. population to get access to that level of like genetic advice from their doctor. And one of the big ways to do that is a really simple software problem, which is just having an API so right. that mm-hmm. you can work with schools like Harvard and their research org and their med school, work with, you know, the NIH to share data. And actually one of our big contributions to the Think for Science and the Precision Medicine Initiative is to just have a standard API that all of the EHRs, all of the electronic health records like us can follow. And it's a very competitive market, you know, with lots of different vendors, and you have big billion-dollar vendors. And I would say for a number of reasons, for competitive reasons, for tech issues, it's been an area where APIs are really deficient. And one reason we're invited to the White House, we're kind of a small, scrappy startup from Silicon Valley still, after all these years.
Right.
You know, we're not a big $20 billion company like Cerner. And, you know, we were one of six vendors invited there. And every other vendor was one of these billion-dollar, multi-billion-dollar companies in this space. Like Cerner's a $20 billion public company. And the reason we were invited there was because we were the only EHR company out there with a working OAuth API that, you know, had RESTful JSON data points. And we opened up this API to, you know, all of Silicon Valley and the whole environment. Our customers can use it and build on it. We're building out an app store-like type model where other people can build on this API and we'll offer it to our customers. So we're That's really cool, leading the way there. And the White House kind of brought us in, I would say, as an example, and also to kind of shame the other vendors and say, hey, you're a $20 billion company and you're going to tell us, you're telling us it's not possible to offer an API that's standard with your competitors and that, you know, it's going to take you 10 years and $10 billion. You know, this small startup did it. Why can't you do it?
That's so
and
cool.
And I think, yeah, and I think it's great to lead the way there and kind of provide an example to say it is that easy. You just open up the API and you know, invest in good security and you listen to your community and you work with other developers and these things are possible. And I think, you know, that goal, which seems decades away, you know, there's lots of little steps there. And one of those steps is just getting the data out of those systems and sharing it with researchers, just building a stable API that's universal so that, you know, if researchers at Harvard or Johns Hopkins want to look at medical records, they can get them out of every system on the market. And for whatever reasons, and there's probably a long story behind it, and I know some of it, you know, all these other vendors were walled gardens where, you know, and you could see they were getting blasted by even people like the New York Times and Wall Street Journal, who were kind of writing op-eds that, hey, these vendors just, you know, they don't even give the hospitals using their software access to their data. And it's just kind of a shady business practice that we've always just had an API and had open access to data. And, you know, as technology people, I think it makes sense. And we're just trying to bring some of that skill set to healthcare.
What are some of the apps you'd like to see on your app store? Specifically, I'm thinking our listeners are entrepreneurial. So what do you want to see people go and build?
We can give some use cases of who have actually built on our
that,
our
that would be great. Yeah. Explain. Tell us some of those.
So one unique one is Wink Health. They actually ship sleep apnea machines to people's houses. People's homes to actually do the diagnosis at home instead of going to a sleep clinic. Another vendor is a company called QDoctor. This company actually auto rebooks appointments. If a patient calls and cancels an appointment, it'll text out 20, 30, 40 other patients. Whoever responds first gets that appointment. The appointment is filled.
And I say two of our largest and most successful partners who've built on our API and we sell into our customers are ZocDoc and Demandforce.
Talk about who they are.
Yeah, ZocDoc, a lot of consumers may think of them as an online appointment booking site that's, you know, available in a lot of major cities. But really to a doctor, the doctors actually pay for the service because it's really a very powerful marketing tool for them that helps them get new patients. And Demandforce is a similar marketing tool, but what it does is it looks at all of the doctors, patients, and history, and they look at it as a business and say, hey, how can I get patients to come back in for their routine follow-up healthcare? But also they're thinking of it as a business, like how can I generate more revenue from this practice? If you're a doctor and your patients don't come in for their annual exams, it's kind of taking a ping on their health and maybe they're in their 20s and 30s and they don't really need it. But you know, it's also costing you as a business. And then there's a lot of other fields of medicine, say dermatology, where there's a lot of elective procedures where, you know, things like Botox and stuff are not medically necessary, but they could be huge revenue drivers for doctors. So they take really innovative ways like that to do email marketing to a doctor's user base. So there's a lot of great tools there. To answer one of your questions, one thing we're working on now is we've built a really basic inventory management system for our doctors that has, really, we designed it to help doctors store vaccines, you know, like flu vaccines and things like that. So not a really super advanced inventory management system, but we built a very basic one that works with, you know, some really key and necessary healthcare type inventory that a doctor needs. And we're getting requests from a lot of doctors who need a more advanced inventory management. So that's actually an API partner. We actually are actively going out and working with inventory management companies to build on our API as well. We don't just wait for people to kind of passively come to us. So we also look for, you know, startups, what other existing tech companies can we work with so that, you know, in a sense, we want to stop having to build everything from our customers. If we have a great app partner who does good work, it saves us from having to, you know, we hear all day from customers asking for
more advanced features. And if we could find an app partner who builds on our platform, it makes us really happy because it's less work for us.
Well, that's an excellent point because you're going to hear those phone calls ringing as people listen to the show. I got another quick question for you. Apple Watch, fad or actual future, actual piece of things? And, you know, specifically, you know, what you're doing with the Apple Watch, but specifically also research kit and care kit from Apple. Can you talk to us about that a bit?
Yeah, so there's this whole movement towards wearables that's happening in healthcare. And I think Apple Watch signifies, you know, from one of the best companies in the world, what's happening. And from the physician standpoint, we actually built an app specifically for them to give them insights into what's happening in their practice very quickly. Hmm. You know, we do a lot of testing at our office, and I gauge what products people are using and continually using. I'm looking at my co-founder right now, Michael, and he's wearing his Apple Watch. I continually wear my Apple Watch. So I think it's a long-term investment. And I think it's something that is going to change the game over time. If you think about the device, does it make people more healthy? Yes, it makes you almost feel more accountable for your health. So you look at your steps, you look at what's happening. It gives you glances about what's happening in your day. I think what Apple did was really well-defined. They made it a good watch, first and foremost. So if you look at your calendar on the watch, it's amazing. I think what we were doing when we rolled out our app, we took that same insight and built who's the next patient that I'm seeing? What's the critical things that I need to know about that patient? So the doctor can look at that very quickly and say, okay, I have 10 more patients coming in. This one's an urgent patient. I need to know about that. It doesn't do everything. And I think the device is not intended to do everything. But the fact that I'm still wearing mine, the fact that my co-founder is still wearing his, it's not just a fad. I think it's something that's going to be here long term, and you're just going to see more and more of the population adopting to this type of technology.
And what do you think of CareKit especially? I mean, that sounds really in your neighborhood. Let me put it that way, as something that you might get into or might not get into. I mean, I'm assuming you've evaluated it to some extent. What do you think of it? Does it present opportunities for patients and, by the way, entrepreneurs?
You know, I'm not really familiar with CareKit, so I'm only peripherally aware of it. So It definitely sounds like an interesting project. I know it's about providing an open platform for sharing healthcare data, and it's definitely something we'll look into and research more and work on. I'm sorry I can't give a better answer. So it's
that's okay. We'll have to have you back. We'll have to have you back in a year and see what's new. Let's wrap up with one little exercise. Imagine, if you will, that you have a little time machine watch on your arm and you can talk into it and you can tell yourselves 7 years ago, at the beginning of this whole process, some little bit of information that you wish you'd known then that you sure as hell now know, what would it be?
Huh.
Okay, let's unwrap that.
That's a really good question. I would say I could give two kinds of answers. I mean, I think...
Go for it.
You know, this is something I've felt for the last few years. I feel like every 6 months or so, I think there's kind of this Moore's law of being an entrepreneur where, especially for early startups, like you learn so much so quickly that every 6 months I felt that if I look back at myself 6 months ago, I'm kind of embarrassed by how naive I was and how little I knew.
That's awesome.
I literally felt like my knowledge was doubling every 6 months. And I look back and I'm like, I can't believe I negotiated this contract this way, or I can't believe I hired this employee, or... You know, so I think there's all sorts of practical things you learn when you become a more seasoned entrepreneur where you just kind of become battle tested and learn a lot of experience. So it's, you know, I would want to send, you know, probably write a short like business book and send it to myself and say, here's all the mistakes you're going to make over the next 7 years. But I don't think, you know, if I had avoided those, I would have made other ones, and I'm sure I'll make more mistakes in the future. So there's all sorts of practical things. I would say, in a really big picture way, I think the one thing that I would really focus on, and this is really thinking long term, is that the number one factor that determines the success of an entrepreneur is their ability to stick with things through adversity. And, you know, I think if you're the kind of person who's tough enough that you could get up every morning and go into your startup and go into your company and kind of get punched in the face a few times, and that's what it feels like sometimes emotionally, where when there's ups and downs, like it really feels like somebody's punching you in the face. The world doesn't want to change. You're trying to change it, and it's kind of punching you in the face to get you to stop. So if you're really just persistent and never give up, you will be successful, and it's going to take a long time. So be patient, and also don't burn yourself out. Don't, you know, there's all these sprint milestones, like, hey, we've got to close this deal. We've got to get this release out. Let's, you know, all hands on deck. We're coming in weekends. We're working late hours and having dinner in the office. And there are those sprint times, but it's also important to just, you know, have a pace where you could do your startup for 10 years and, you know, be happy with your life, not miserable, and feel good about it. So I would say that maybe the one piece of advice that I think is pretty universal is just really don't ever give up and really focus, no matter how bad the ups and downs are, just stick with it and you will be successful.
That's pretty good advice.
I think also when there are stressful times, not to stress out too much about things, because sometimes they're a lot smaller than you actually realize over time.
Yeah, I think one piece of advice as well, like an old adage, I actually don't know where it's from, but it's a saying that things are never as bad as they seem, and they're also never as good as they seem.
Right.
I think that might also sum it up, because sometimes you're going through a crisis and you're like, this is the worst thing that ever happened. And from Ben Horowitz's book, The Hard Thing About Hard Things, there are these whiffio moments, you know, we're fucked, it's over moments, where you just think it's all done. Like, we're just going to all go home and we're not going to be here tomorrow. And once you survive like five or six of those, and I think we've, you know, survived about that many, you realize to put them in perspective. And also when things feel super good, when you think you're on top of the world, it also is good to remember that adage so you don't become really arrogant. And just think like, hey, we're the best people in the world because things are going well. You should be very humble and realize something could happen at any moment. Something could happen in an hour or tomorrow or a month from now that will really humble me and put me back in one of these whiffy moments where things all seem lost. So I think remembering that, hey, when things are really terrible, they're not that bad. And also when things seem really amazing, be humble and kind of treat other people really well. Because tomorrow, you know, you may be very humbled and need to go to people for help. So don't, and it's easy when you're very arrogant and yep. You think you have the upper hand against, you know, just anyone, your investors or even other companies. Like, you should never be a jerk to them. Those things will always haunt you and come back. And there will be one time in the future where you're going to be going to that person hat in hand asking for their help. So don't ever be a jerk to them. Always try and treat people well. So just to kind of round out my attitude, maybe incorporate Dan's.
I also think. Go ahead. Sorry.
I also think just trusting your gut and being more vocal about it. So when you have an instinct about something maybe being wrong, just at least verbalizing that to the team and letting them know. I think that's critical for everyone here, and it creates a good culture.
Yeah, and I would just tell one kind of funny anecdote about that. That Dan said, sometimes when you're hiring people, you may not hire someone who's good. You may hire someone that for whatever reason, they really don't work out. And you look back and you think, God, I wish I didn't hire that person. And me and Dan, you know, we take hiring really seriously. We interview every single employee that we let into the company. And whenever we've had an employee who kind of hasn't worked out, and you kind of look back and say, what lessons can we learn? There'll often be times where me and Dan are just chatting about it. And we're like, you know, I had a really bad, saw this really bad red flag during the interview, but I didn't say anything. And the other person's like, why the heck didn't you say anything? And it's like, well, you just kind of learn to trust yourself to say something and bring those objections out into the open. So it's really important because you never want to feel that way when, you know, it's like, well, why didn't you say something 2 years ago or 6 months ago or a month ago when you knew there was this horrible feeling? Like, say something next time. You don't have to say it in front of them, but, you know, let's go for a walk to Starbucks and get a coffee and you could share why you have a bad feeling about, you know, whether it's a person or a business deal.
Yep.
And you just kind of learn to trust that. And I think everyone kind of has this feeling of, you know, hey, when I sit in a room with this person, it's not the kind of person I want to be.
But it's also product. It's not just people. It's also product. Like the API, when we first started this, I had a really strong inkling. We need to do something about this. I don't want to be one of these other vendors who locks their data in.
Right.
And you get a lot of these insights in your gut and you can't really explain it, but you just kind of push forward. And sometimes you go against that, and that at least vocalize it to the team and let them know what you're thinking and why you're thinking it. Because if there's a good product out there and you don't say anything, you're going to miss it.
That's really interesting.
And it goes with people, ideas, products, everything that's out there.
Well, Michael, Daniel, thank you so much for chatting with us again. And one of the effects of the approach you've taken, and I think that the last little bit of advice, is that people cheer for you. I vaguely remember seeing a news story about your meeting with the president, or I thought I saw your name in a story and smiled, because it's just, you're a company that's easy to cheer for. And that's something that people like us are definitely wanting you to succeed. So thank you for spending some time with us, and keep crushing.
And let's not be such a stranger. We'll have to talk to you again in less than 5 years, okay?
We'll try not to cancel our podcast during that time again. So.
And I'm glad you guys have the podcast back. It's great.
Well, thanks.
We definitely listen. So.
No, that just is bizarre to me, but thank you. I appreciate it. All right, guys. We'll talk to you more soon.
Thank you.
Okay. Thanks. Bye-bye. Thanks for listening to the Startup Success Podcast with Bob Walsh and Patrick Foley. Be sure to subscribe to the show on iTunes, like our Facebook page, and follow us on Twitter. And then go build a useful and valuable software company.